For all of you three? So here we are going to see about the eye part. And in this picture, what you are going to see is, so this we call it as eyelashes. So these hair-like projections from the eye is eyelashes. And this is upper eyelid and this is lower eyelid. And the circle, we call it as pupil. So this is the window for light. So when the doctor put torchlight in front of the eye, this pupil will decrease its size. And when you are entering into the movie theater, this hole will increase its size. So that was the characteristic feature of this pupil. And this we call it as iris. So this blue color part is the iris. So it depends on the person. For some people, it will be black. For some people, it will be blue. And for some other people, it will be brown. There are many colors for this iris muscle. And this iris muscle contraction only will increase and decrease the size of the pupil. And this part, this white color part, we call it as sclera. So sclera and pupil and iris. So the very outer region of the eye, if we touch, it will be a bit transparent. So this we call it as cornea. So this very outer part of the layer. So let's get into the topic. So usually vision is the very far most important of the five senses. So coming to the five important senses of the body are, so vision, taste, smell, hearing, touch. So these are the very five important senses of our body. Among that, the vision is the primary sense. Usually 75% of the information we gather through vision only. So visual information is very, very important. So we usually compare the eye with camera. What the camera will do? The camera will capture the light, and that will capture the light in the lens. And from through the lens, it will capture the light and it will make a picture on the negative. It was previous cameras, old cameras. But now we have digital cameras. So what the overall the camera will do is it will capture the light. We can't take the photographs in dark. That is only possible with infrared cameras. So, but with normal cameras, we can't take a picture in the dark time. So we are capturing the light. The same thing was done by our eye. Our eye is also capturing the light and putting the image on the retina. After capturing the image on the retina, so the image, so whatever the image will go to the brain, and finally it will be under our conscious what we are seeing. So that the same thing what the camera will do, and the eye also will be the same. And in both the camera and the eye, we have the lenses. Lenses usually will adjust, and according to adjusting will focus on the object. So the clarity is mainly based on focusing of the lenses. So finally, it will create a picture on a specialized layer. We call it as retina. So let's see how the eye will work. So eyes will have eyelids. So anteriorly means front. So the front part of the eye are protected by eyelids. So which meet at the medial and lateral corners of the eye. So you can see the eyelids. So this we call it as medial and lateral corners. So nearby this corners, the eyelids was fused. And we call that as medial and lateral canthus respectively. So eyelashes. Eyelashes are nothing but, so the, So eyelashes. Eyelashes are nothing but the hair-like projections projecting from the eyelids. And tarsal glands. So these glands are the oil-secreting glands. So the oil-secreting glands in our body, we call it as sebaceous glands. So in between the eyelid edges, so we have the sebaceous glands. So these will produce the oily secretions that lubricates the eye. So we also have another type of glands, we call it as ciliary glands. So ciliary glands are the modified sweat glands. So that are present between the eyelids, between the eyelashes. and conjunctiva. Conjunctiva is a very delicate membrane, so that will fuse the outer surface of the eyeball to the cornea. So from the cornea to the eyelid, we have a connection. So that layer, that connecting layer, we call it as conjunctive. You can remind this layer very easily. Like usually, we will get an eye infection. We call that as Madras eye. So usually, we call it as Madras eye. But the actual medical term for that is conjunctivitis. Inflammation of this conjunctiva layer, we call it as conjunctivitis or Madras eye. And lacrimal apparatus. So the lacrimal apparatus are the thing which produces the tears. So the lacrimal apparatus are nothing but lacrimal gland. So we have the lacrimal, in the whole lacrimal apparatus, we have the lacrimal duct and lacrimal duct, lacrimal gland, lacrimal duct, which release the lacrimal secretions into the nose. So usually when we are crying, we get the tears into nose. That was a common thing. So the excess amount of the tears which was outflown, that will come out of the eyes. That was the only thing. So whatever the tears, it has to finally drain into the nose. So the overflowing of the tears only will come out of the eye. And coming to the next, lacrimal gland. So lacrimal gland or tear producing glands. So these are located in the lateral corner. Lateral corner means outside of the eye. So I'll show you in the picture. So this we call it as medial corner. And this was the lateral corner. Nearby the lateral corner only we have the lacrimal glands. So located in the lateral end of the each eye, which is continually will release the salty secretion. Tears are nothing but the salty secretions onto the front of the eyeball through small tube-like structures. That small tube, we call it as lacrimal ducts. So usually the lacrimal glands are exocrine glands, which will release its secretions outside the blood. And lacrimal canaliculi. So usually from the lacrimal duct, the tears will flush into this lacrimal sac and finally will have a connection with nose. So that connection we call it as nasolacrimal duct. It will finally empties the tears. It will drain all the tears into the nose. And lysozyme. Lysozyme is the enzyme present in the tears. So usually it was a saying that crying is good for health. So why crying is good for health is because of this lysozyme enzyme. Lysozyme enzyme will kill the bacteria, virus, or anything on the face. So that was secreted through the tears that usually cleans and protect the eye surface and moistens and lubricates it. Usually the tears are very beneficial to us. And next, extrinsic eyeball muscles. Usually we can move our eyeball. Means not moving, we can rotate our eyeball. We can rotate our eye to upward, downward, side to side, and upside down, and upside lateral, upside medial. All these things are possible because of extrinsic eyeball muscles. Totally, we have 6 extrinsic eyeball muscles. So, the 6 extrinsic eyeball muscles are lateral rectus, medial rectus. So, the meaning of rectus means straight. The muscle will be straight in nature. Well, it will be like a straight band. That's why they named it as rectus. Lateral rectus, medial rectus. Superior rectus, inferior rectus. Inferior oblique, superior oblique. So you can just remind like. So this was the medial rectus. Medial rectus. And this side it is lateral rectus. Superior rectus, inferior rectus. Superior oblique, inferior oblique. Likewise, we have the 6 extrinsic eyeball muscles. Because of the 6 extrinsic eyeball muscles only, our eyeball can move upward, downward, side to side, upward side, and upward medial. So, this was the entire picture of eyeball. So, usually, the eyeball is divided into 3 layers. So, let's see one by one. So the very outer layer of the eyeball, we call it as fibrous layer. In the outer layer of the eyeball, we have this white color part. So this white color part, we call it as sclera. So when you come to the front part, so we have this transparent region, which we call it as cornea. So in the outer region, we have two important structures. One is sclera and other one is cornea. Okay. So these two layers are very important that will make the fibrous layer, which is highly protective in nature. So if we take off this layer, and this layer is the middle layer, we also call it as vascular layer. So then vascular meaning is it has rich blood supply. So someone, if you could mute it. So the middle layer, we call it as choroid layer. So the choroid or vascular layer. So this is highly vascular in nature because of huge blood supply. And you can see this when coming to the posterior part, this layer is choroid. So when the choroid is coming to the front, here we have ciliary apparatus. This entire thing we call it as ciliary apparatus. In the ciliary apparatus, we have ciliary body, and this is ciliary jonule, or we also call it as suspensory ligaments, because this ciliary jonule or suspensory ligaments is suspending or holding this lens. And when you come to the very front part, this is iris muscle. So this was the colored part of the eye, black, brown, like light brown, blue, everything will lies in this iris muscle. In the center of this iris, we have a hole, or we call it as a circular part. This gap, we call it as pupil. So these are the parts in the middle layer. So choroid, ciliary body, ciliary jonule, iris muscle, and lens. And this part is the pupil. And this usually the lens is biconvex in structure, and it is transparent and crystalline in nature. So this is transparent and very soft lens, this one. And coming to the innermost layer is the retina, which we also call it as nervous layer. And in this nervous layer, this is the very important layer, retina. In the retina, we have two types of sensory receptors. One is rods and other one is cones. Rods are responsible for dim light vision. For example, when you enter into the dark room or when you enter into the movie theater, usually the receptors which is responsible for our vision is rods. And cones, we have another receptors which we call it as cones. Someone, could you please mute it? Okay. So, and the other type of photoreceptors which we call it as cones. And cones are responsible for bright light vision. So what and all the colors, what and all the things we are seeing normally during the daytime, that is actually because of cones. And the nighttime vision and the dark vision, that was actually because of rods. So we have rods and cones. Okay. And this part we call it as fovea centralis. So this in this fovea centralis, mostly the cones only will be there. There will be no rods. And this part we call it as optic disc or blind spot. Here, we don't have any rods or any cones. There will be no any photoreceptors. And this we call it as optic nerve. And the entire interior of the eyeball was splitted by this lens. So this lens was going to split the interior of the eyeball into two chambers. So this front chamber in front of this lens, we call it as aqueous chamber. And this backside of this lens, we call this chamber as vitreous chamber because of the presence of vitreous humor. So the aqueous chamber is watery in nature and the vitreous chamber is jelly in nature. Okay. This was the entire anatomy of the eye. So any doubts regarding this entire anatomy of the eye?
Nope.
Venkatesh?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Subhash?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So let's see the part again one by one. The eyeball. So the eyeball itself is a hollow sphere. So actually, this hollow sphere shape is maintained by this vitreous humor only. This was jelly-like thing that only will maintain the spherical shape of the eyeball. And it was composed of three layers, as we have seen. And the interior of the eyeball is filled with fluids. In front of the lens, it was aqueous fluid. And back of the lens, it is vitreous fluid. And coming to the layers that forming the eyeball. So the eyeball was being covered by three layers. So coming to the first layer, this first layer is fibrous layer. So this was actually protective in nature. It consists of two parts. The white color part of the eyeball. If we see our eyeball also, the white color region, we call it as sclera. So the sclera is actually very thick and white connective tissue. So present in the front of the eyeball. And next, cornea. Cornea was actually the center front portion of the eyeball. And that was crystal clear. And we call this as window. Because of the transparency only, the light will enter into the eyeball. And the second layer, vascular layer, which was the middle layer of the eyeball. In the middle layer, we have choroid, ciliary body, and iris muscle. And choroid. Choroid was present in the back side. It was having rich blood supply. And the pigment prevents the light from scattering inside. So, you know, it will direct the light into one direction, not to go here and there. That was the actual main thing of the choroid. So, the choroid is also dark pigmented layer. And ciliary body. We all know, in the ciliary body, we have a ciliary joinune. And suspensory, we also call it a suspensory ligaments, ciliary body, and the iris muscle. So in the center of the iris muscle, the round opening, we call it as pupil. From the cornea, the light will go through the pupil into the lens. So sensory layer, which was the innermost layer, and we call that layer as retina. In the retina, so, which was the pigmented, the outer pigmented layer of the retina is composed of pigmented cells. So, which will usually absorb the light and prevent the light from scattering. And the innermost layer, we call it as neural layer. So, right? So, it has two photoreceptors. One is rods and other one is cones. Rods is responsible for dim light vision. And cones is responsible for bright light vision. So we have a two new neuron chain. So just remind this. So starting from the optic nerve, so which is the second cranial nerve, it has bipolar cells and then ganglionic cells and then optic nerve will start from there. And that optic nerve will go to the optic cortex, which is present in the occipital lobe of the brain. If anything happens to the backside of the brain, the person will become blind. If any injury to the backside of the brain, that particularly occipital lobe of the cerebrum, because the optic nerve will go to the occipital lobe of the cerebrum. From the eye, first bipolar cells will start. The bipolar cells will join with ganglionic cells. And again, the ganglionic cells will join with optic nerve. The optic nerve will go to the occipital lobe of the brain. There only we will come to know what we are seeing actually. Optic disc. This was the place. There will be no any rods or cones. So that's why we call it as blind spot. And fovea centralis. This was the part we have only the cones. No rods will be present. So in this picture, you can see clearly about the lacrimal glands. So this was the lateral portion. This was the medial portion. Medial means near to the center of the body. Lateral means away from the center of the body. So this was lateral and this was medial. This is the lacrimal gland and these are the lacrimal ducts of the lacrimal gland. From here only the tears will be coming. So the tears will roll around the eyeball and it will go from here into this lacrimal canaliculi. So So this we call it as lacrimal canaliculus, which will join to the nasolacrimal duct. So from here, it will go to this inferior opening. This we call it as inferior meatus. From here only, the tears will be discharged into the nose. So this was the side picture. So this was the eyelids, upper eyelids, lower eyelids. And here we have the tarsal glands, which also call it as sebaceous glands or oil secreting glands. So this is the conjunctiva. So to the eyelids and the eyeball, we have a connection that is conjunctive. And this is the lacrimal gland. And lens. Lens are the transparent lens, which is flexible and biconvex. It was crystal-like structure. The lens will divide the eyeball into two chambers. The front chamber, we call it as aqueous chamber. And the back chamber, we call it as vitreous chamber. So the aqueous chamber consists of aqueous humor. And the vitreous chamber consists of vitreous humor. And actually, the vitreous humor prevents the eyeball from collapsing. And the aqueous chamber was nothing but the whatever the blood plasma consists of, the same liquid will be there in the eyeball. That is nothing but aqueous humor. So that will be continuously secreted by the choroid layer. So usually, the aqueous humor will help to maintain the intraocular pressure. Intraocular pressure means the pressure inside the eyeball. And canal of sclum. The aqueous humor was continuously drained by canal of sclum. So which was present at the junction between the sclera and cornea. So aqueous humor was produced by choroid and drained by canal of sclum. And coming to the eye reflexes. What is an eye reflex is? Suddenly, if you touch the eyeball, so we suddenly will close with eyelids. So that was actually a reflex, which happens without our control, without our conscious control. That we call it as a reflex. For example, if someone put a flashlight on our eyeball, suddenly we will close the eye. So that is also a form of reflex. Let's see the two important reflex. First one is photopupillary reflex. When your eyes was exposed to the bright light, the pupils will decrease its size. Okay, so usually the pupils will decrease its size, and that we call it as photopupillary reflex. At the same time, so when you are entering into the dark room, for example, when you switch on the bed light, at that time the pupil will increase its size. When someone put a flashlight or floodlights in front of you, your pupil will decrease its size. When you are entering into your room, which you have only the bed light, small bed light, then your pupil will increase its size. This type of reflex we call it as photopupillary reflex. According to the light, the pupil will react. That's the thing. Next, accommodation reflex. This is very simple. For example, you're very far away from the thing. So when you're very far away, you can't see the things or objects properly. So what we will do is, we will go near to the object. So when coming, I think, Subhash, can you please mute it?
Okay.
So when you're getting near to the object, you can able to see actually what the thing is. The detailing of the object can only be seen when you are getting near to the object. When you are far away from the object, you can't able to read the thing, or you can't able to locate what is the thing also. So when you are getting closure only, this we call it as accommodation pupillary reflex. When you are getting near, your pupil will actually adjust its size to see the things clearly. And next, let's see the medical terminologies. Blepharo means eyelids. Choroid means choroido, which is choroid. Conjunctivo, which means conjunctiva. Myringo is eardrum. Oto means ear. Retino, which is retina. And tympano means eardrum. Corneo, which is cornea. Irido, which is iris. Corio, coro, or pupillo, which means pupil. Facco, facco means lens. Photo, which is light. Gonio, which means angle. Aqua or hydro, which is water. Dacryo or lacrimo, which is tears or lacrimal apparatus. Kerato, which is horny tissue, heart or cornea. Optico, which is eye or vision. Ambilo, ambilo means dull or dim vision. Presbyo, presbyo means old age. And let's see the pathological conditions. Ambilopia, ambilo means dull. Opia means vision. So ambilopia means dull vision or reduced vision. So usually this is not correctable with refraction. Means we can't correct the dull vision with glasses or lens. So there will be no any pathology. So they have to undergo some type of surgery. And coming to the next thing, aphakia. Facco means lens. Aphakia means absence of lens. In cataract surgery, usually cataracts is very common for diabetic people or old age people. In the cataract surgery, the lens will become cloudy, opaque. So what they will do is, in cataract surgery, they will remove the lens. So during that time, we call it as aphakia. Esthenopia. Estheno means weakness. Opia means vision. So weakness of the vision, or we also call it as eye strain. For example, if we work on a laptop for around 4 to 5 hours, our eye will strain. Or we are watching a movie for more than 3 hours, and our eyes will get strained. That we call it as esthenopia. And next, astigmatism, which is inability to focus on the things. We also call it as blurred vision. And blepharitis. Blepharitis is inflammation of the eyelids. So the eyelids will become red, crusting and scales on the base of the eyelids. This is due to some type of bacterial infection. Blepharoptosis. This is very common for paralytic people. So they can't able to open the eyelids. Their eyelids will fall down. So this is very common. They can't open the eyelids and they can't make the eyelids to stay. So this is very common in aging and some type of muscle diseases also, such as myasthenia gravis and stroke. Blindness. A complete or partial loss of vision, we call it as blindness. Cataract. Cataract is usually common in the diabetic people. So their lens will become cloudy. Means they lose the normal transparency. Some type of protein molecules that get accumulated in the lens due to over sun exposure or due to some type of injury or because of smoking also, they will get cataracts. And using some type of medications. Color blindness. Some people, they can't differentiate between red and green. If we ask them to see the red color and ask them what is the color, they will tell it as green. If you show them the green color, they will tell it as red. They can't able to differentiate these two colors because of the issue with the photoreceptors. That we call it as color blindness. So, and next, conjunctivitis. Inflammation of the conjunctiva, we call it as conjunctivitis. The person will have severe itching and continuously tears will be getting out of the eyeball. And dacryocytis, which is inflammation of the lacrimal gland. Diabetic retinopathy. Because of diabetes, so the retina will get the disease. So because of the fragile or weak retinal blood vessels, easily the retinal blood vessels will rupture. And you can see the micro bleeding or micro aneurysms, we call it as, on the retina. So that was retinopathy. The person may get blindness also because of diabetes. And diplopia, which we also call it as double vision. So usually they see the things as a double. So this is very common in stroke patients. And diplopia, you can usually see for the drunken people also. And ectropion. Ectropion, we also call it as squint eye. The eyeball will be rotated outwards. And that will be fixed in that position. That we call it as ectropion. And exophthalmos, which is a condition in hyperthyroidism. it will be looks like the eyeball is protruding out of the eyelids, so out of the sockets. That we call it as exophthalmos. And esotropia and exotropia. So if you see some people, they'll from birth itself, the one of their eyeball will be turned outside or inside and fixed in that position. So in Telugu, we usually will call it as mellakannu. I'm not sure in Tamil. Okay. So cross eye and wall eye. Cross eye means the eyeball will be turning outwards. Sorry, inwards we call it as esotropia. When the eyeball is turning outwards, we call it as exotropia. Exo means outside, eso means inside. And glaucoma. Glaucoma is because of increased intraocular pressure. So, inability of the aqueous humor to circulate freely. So, this also leads to progressive blindness. And hemianopia. Only one half of the eyeball is only visible. So they can only see with one half of their eyeball. Remaining half of the eyeball will become blind. This is also common in stroke, brain stroke. And hordeolum, which is inflammation or infection to the sebaceous glands. So nothing but the tarsal glands of the eyelids. And hyperopia. So we have two conditions here. Hyperopia. Hyperopia means farsightedness. So they can able to see the things very far away from them. And they can't able to see the things near to them. So for these people, they can't able to read the newspaper. They can't able to drive. And they can't able to watch the TV. So these things will be a problematic for hyperopia. And keratitis, inflammation of cornea, we call it as keratitis. Next, macular degeneration. Macular degeneration means the macular tissue will be broken down and they will lose the central vision. Losing the central vision means they can't read, they can't drive, they can't watch the television. So they can't perfectly focus on a thing. That was the thing. Meiosis, abnormal size of the pupils. Mydriasis, abnormal dilation of the pupils. So meiosis means abnormally, the pupils will be smaller in size. In mydriasis, abnormally, the pupils are larger in size. And myopia. Myopia is near-sightedness. Hyperopia is far-sightedness. In myopia, they can able to see the things near to them. But they can't focus on the things far away from them, which is quite opposite to hyperopia. Nactylopia, which is night blindness. And the inability to see well in dim light. And nighttime, they can't able to focus and see. This is because of vitamin A deficiency, retinol deficiency. Nystagmus. So this is seen when the patient is having any injury to the cerebellum. So their eyeball will be moving like a pendulum. So that condition we call it as nystagmus. So the eyeball will not stop moving. Continuously, it will be keep on moving. Ophthalmopathy. Any eye disease, we call it as ophthalmopathy. And next, papil edema. So, edema to that optic disc, where we don't have any rods or cones. So, that is because of increase in intracranial pressure. Because of any head injury, this may happen. And photophobia. So, there are people who can't able to focus on the camera for long duration. So, they'll get tears. So, that condition, we call it as photophobia. So they'll become hypersensitive to light. So they can only see the things where they can only tolerate the light for a very short period of time. They can't able to see the light for a long duration. They can't able to see the sunlight also directly. And presbyopia. Presby means old age. Opia means vision. So the loss of flexibility of the lens because of the blurry near vision and loss of accommodation. Because of old age, this is very common. And retinal detachment. So the retina will get separated from the choroid layer because of the head trauma in diabetes and weak retinal vessels. This will be possible. If this was the case, the person will become blind. And trachoma. Trachoma is a chronic infectious disease, usually seen in the poverty-ridden areas. So because of the bacteria called chlamydia trachomatis. And uveitis, inflammation of the center layer, center choroid layer. We call it as uveitis. So coming to the clinical procedures. Okay, I'll disconnect the session and I'll reconnect it. Are you fine?